Hello and welcome back to Cautionary Global Scientific Analysis. This study is titled Complex Systems and Pathogenesis, a Multi-Layered Etiological Reference. The study provides a general reference of factors that can cause and perpetuate illness, etiological being the study of causes or origins. To unravel causation, a multi-layered approach is introduced that incorporates complex system dynamics. It's also recognized that idiopathic and random pathogenic factors also can play a role. Now, in a previous study, the systemic origins of pathogenesis were looked at in this study called Econobiology Notes, and that can be referred to here. The introduction goes into a kind of into the logic of causation and towards resolution. Although this introductory section may be kind of tedious, so we won't go into too much detail, but it there's some really important context for understanding how to unravel these causal issues that are not obvious at the outset. And so this goes through that. Although it is tedious, there is some background literature on causation to the famous Bradford Hill and others are listed here. There's an example of a non-identification of cause and how that leads to a whole bunch of problems, using an example of a person who's got skin inflammation and what kind of the things that he or she would be experiencing potentially if they go to get treated, and how those problems can compound. In the next section here, of course, in the same introduction, the multi-layered nature of causality talks about causal confusion. There's just so many different possible causes, and trying to unravel all that actually does require some work and logical reasoning. The way to kind of handle this topic is to go through a scenario. And so, kind of jumping ahead, there's basically four levels to this scenario and a bunch of qualifications. And a particular example is used here with toxin quote X unquote. This toxin X is considered to be the pathological source, but it really could be a lot of different things, including lack of nutrients, exhaustion, or lack of sleep or rest. All of those other things could cause illness. Extreme stress, including emotional stress, can be causes of illness, and so on and so forth. There's a whole bunch there. And then this, what may be helpful here is this chart one, which is scenario and flow of causation towards resolution. And it goes basically first, as I said earlier, the levels. So level one, level two, level three, level four by row here, and then each column. And starting with a situation where you have, the true cause turns out, which is right here, true cause turns out to be this supposed toxin X. Okay, so toxin X, the person comes in ill, and an unrelated cause is identified, and then that leads to, you know, treating an error, and so on. And there's other examples here, and it goes through. It's a little too long for the video, but there's an explanation of how the chart works, the logic, how that goes through, and just a quick definition as far as treatment doesn't necessarily imply to always to administer medications. It could also be elimination of something from, say, for your diet or your lifestyle, avoidance of exposure to something in the environment, or supplementation in cases of, say, deficient nutrients and so on. So as far as solutions and quote-unquote cures. And of course, there's lots of examples that are provided in the etiological reference, which we'll see below. So anyway, we go through the levels, these kind of causation or logic levels, if you want to call them that, and all the way down to level four. And then a kind of a warning here as to the risk to the public that you can actually get without really unraveling the causation properly. You can get this compounding of harms. And that really is aided by the system of political management, which was again talked about in the previous study on econobiology. But this goes through an example here, which we won't go into detail, but where you actually, by not properly identifying something, you can actually compound the problem and create more illness and more problems in the society. So that's a really important one to look at. It's emphasized throughout the text that concept should be understood. So logic really is important to this whole process of resolving things, but it is actually somewhat tedious to go through that process and really think it through. So then we go into the etiological reference here, and the section is organized basically by categories. And so we'll jump here quickly to categories. There's seven categories here, starting with immunology and the immune system, then medical and slash iatrogenic factors, which iatrogenic is basically something that's caused by a doctor or a medical professional. And that's it could be also named healers that harm, unfortunately, which can happen. Ingestion of things, foods, liquids, diet, biological, microbiological sources of illness, which can be connected also in parentheses here, sanitation and encroachment on animal habitats by humans. Exposure in some kind of environmental, factor, lifestyle and personal factors, and then seven is kind of a catch-all. So far, there's just one on prion disease and some of the possible causation there, but that's left kind of unresolved here at this point. But definitely warrants further examination. So then, we have a list of clarifications and qualifications, quite detailed here. For beginning with underlying systemic factors that need to be understood to really get the big picture of everything. Also, the role of the immune system in all of this, because people think, oh, you're sick. Well, that's and often will not connect it at all to the immune system and possible problems with immune system health. So that's a really important part of that whole the whole analysis process. In terms of understanding pathogenesis, then so we go through this all of these different examples. We just don't really have enough time to go through all of them in detail here. And then so first category one, immunology and immune system dynamics. There's some explanation on this fundamental role of the immune system, which can't be overemphasized. It really is so key to a lot of this. There's an excellent quote from Nature Immunology, which explains how pathogenesis occurs as a consequence of complex interactions between an infecting pathogen and the immune system. So pathogenesis can thus be dramatically influenced by host variability. So different people, if they have strong immune systems, can obviously fight off things, whereas people with weak immune or compromised immune systems may not have that same capability. So building the immune system is a real part, a really important part of this whole process. And so we go a little bit more into that here. And then, of course, a clarification again, which has been done in some of the other studies by this author, myself, on the essentially the extremely misleading nature and potentially dangerous nature of these testing procedures and these test kits and so on. That we go into that a little bit with a seminal study by Borger and others in 2020 that needs to be referred. Causal confusion of illness. We've kind of gone through that already, but there's some more examples of that, and the link to the immune system and how our immune system actually is often the cause of many, let's just say, what we call illnesses. It's because of an immune system overreaction. And there's also an excellence of several sources here that discuss that, including the immune system reaction to gram-negative bacteria and things like that, which is considered to be a public health issue, but a lot of that has to do with the immune system reaction to things. And then very important is, and probably overlooked in most cases, is confusion. The body gets confused between something that's itself or part of itself and non-self, that's something that's not part of itself. And when that confusion happens, that can also cause a lot of problems. And the concern, of course, is any relationship with autoimmune diseases and things like that. That's really very, very concerning, because the body is attacking itself because it's identifying certain things as foreign that are actually part of the body. So this is really a very bad situation. But a lot of this hopefully can help unravel some of the causes of these types of conditions. So moving on to basically a list along with a lot of sample references here, but of the types of things that can cause immune system issues. And some of them can be iatrogenic causes of immunosuppression, nutritional deficiencies, lack of sleep. And these are all, I must say also, these are also connected to other categories too. There's a lot of overlap here. And category two, so this is the iatrogenics. This is where doctors can actually cause harm. The injectables, going through different things, immunosuppression, injectables, a lot of different problems with adverse events from contaminants, adjuvants, experimental untested or relatively newer formulations that can be very dangerous, nanoparticles within formulations, dermatological reactions or reactivation of different types of, say, for example, latent herpes zoster viruses, things like that's been looked at by authors like Seneff and so on. And overprescribing of medications, which can lead to chemical dependency and chronic iatrogenic illness and so on. Analgesics, painkillers, fever-reducing medications were commonly used, also may be linked to certain conditions that have been studied by scientists like William Parker. That's noted here, acetaminophen, for example. Anyway, there's a lot here, but just to give a brief overview, allergic reactions, intentional non-treatment by policy protocol, actually fraudulent, but also can cause damage and hurt people. Screening issues, blood banks, medical hygiene issues, it just goes on and on here. Category three, foods, agricultural chemicals in our foods. Obviously, that's often talked about. Genetically modified foods and organisms that are not fully understood and can lead to ecocide, which is the destruction of our environment, permanent destruction. Irreversible destruction of our environment. This is also a major factor as well. Water contamination, wastewater processing issues, and we can go through here. Heavy metals poisoning, just jumping around through here. Manufacturing processes can be very harmful to the local people living in the area. Nanoparticles in food and drink is also a very big concern that has been addressed actually in some parts of the world. Already, the nanoparticulate matter in the air, chemical pollutants in the air, airborne soils, water. This has been also looked at with the phenomenon of cloud seeding, weather modification, which is increasingly popular in many countries, but also have been in some places have already been banned or are being looked at very closely. Microplastics polluting our actually our bodies, leaching from containers, dietary habits. And that can cause all sorts of problems, obviously sweeteners, high sugar diets, sweets, hard candies, excessive fat, insufficient fiber diets, and also sometimes new diets that actually are not quite fully understood could cause problems. Chitins could be an example. Nuts, things like nuts are supposed to be good for you, but there are things that you have to be aware of, aflatoxins, and there could be side effects there and could be dangerous in some cases. So that needs to be looked at further. And category four, biological, microbiological. This is, of course, probably not any surprise, parasitic effect, infections. That type of thing, a bacteria, excuse me, vector-borne, where let's say a fly or some kind of insect would carry the particular pathogen, and then but one thing to be clear on again is environment. If humans are going into an environment and they get there's say for example where there's snakes and there's more snake bites, it may not necessarily be the fault of the snakes, it's the humans actually encroaching on the environment of the snakes. Or changes in the snake's environment that causes snakes to come to the human area and cause these problems. So, exposure, environmental, all sorts of types of pollution or radiation, this kind of thing, UV. Then lifestyle and personal. This is also really important. It's very easy to miss, but all sorts of activities that we just do on a daily basis can actually be quite harmful. This concludes the video. For further details, be sure to check out the show notes and the links there. Thank you very much for listening.